flies, which are a little bit different for me. I don't fish a ton of dries. Living here in Northern California, we fish a quite a big assortment of nymphs and stuff like that. We swing a lot of flies. But when it comes to salmon fly season, which is our next big push we should be having here, I can't help but want to throw dry flies. So, checking out the chat functions right now. And I'm going to go through two. One's kind of a little sneaky guy that I've been using for a few years now. And the other one is just a stimulator with a twist. Of course, I have to throw a twist into it because it would be boring if I just did the one in the picture. Then everybody would know what was happening and so forth. So, I'm just getting my dubbing ready. But, yeah, we're going to tie these guys up and go from there. No chat? Chat function might be broken? Again. But we'll see. So, anyways, I'm going to get up on the up close and personal on the vise here, and we'll show you how I do the extended bodies. Let's see. There's the vise. Plain colored shirt with no buttons. Getting smarter. It's only been 3 years or so or something like that. 2 or 3 years that I've been doing this. Mina, hello. Welcome. Welcome and hello. So all I'm going to throw in here is, and I'll center this guy up because this is going to throw it off just a bit. This is just a tube fly pin that I use for tying tube flies. But I also use it as an extended body tool as well. It's kind of a fun little cheat. Rob, hello. Carl, no audio? No way. This is not good. Is your volume up? Let's see if anybody else has the no audio issue. Let's see what we get going here. Never seen a no audio. Hey Frank, how's it going? Just cleaning this. I want my thread to come off nice and smooth. Carl, your computer might be muted. So far nobody else has complained about no audio. So I'm going to start my thread, and this is just a orange thread, and I just do a few wraps. Mr. Ebers, hello. Mr. Ebers, do you have audio? You're a trusted advisor, sir. Let me know how your audio sounds. Looks like I'm going to have to do the refresh game again. And what this is just a piece of 3/8 or a 3/8 inch wide by 2 mil fly tying foam. It's kind of a earthy sienna brown. If you have any other color, we'll show you how to work with that too. Let's see here. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to start by creating body segments. I got audio. Joe, what's up, man? Hello and welcome to the live stream, brother. Been digging on those hooks of yours. Got to tie with them for like an hour the other day in between my traveling. So all I'm doing here, see, I kind of mess up a little bit every once in a while, is I'm just creating body segments. And I'm just loosely wrapping this. And trying to bring it a little bit bigger. And I'm not wrapping really tightly, but you can see I'm trying to create just a little bit larger body segmentation as I move forward. And this is going to be a big fly. Definitely you can handle this on your 5-weight, but whoa, tripping out. We'll try to refresh again. I'm trying to get to everybody's comments, but the commentary section is not liking me. So after I have about an inch, there we go. John says audio works. Matthew has audio. Bob has audio. Everybody has Matt Evers, but I have no comments. All right, so I'm just going to do a simple hand whip finish here. And I'm going to trim this off. Now, this is pretty vanilla right here. If you guys can see this, it's pretty boring. I don't love the colorway of just the stock. The stock foam. So what I do is I actually use the airbrush gun, and I'll go ahead and airbrush this. And I'm only going to airbrush the bottom. I don't want to do a ton of extra work for stuff I don't have to. So I do quite a few colors on this. The first one is Tuscan Orange Copic marker, and I'm going to go all the way up all of the, throughout, kind of see here, kind of darkens it up just a bit. Then I'm just going to use your standard orange. Refresh and it's all good. Yes, I do too much refreshing. So I'm going to come in and just start highlighting with a little bit of orange. I don't know if you guys will be able to pick that up in there, but it just gives it a cool little highlight. Oops, I wanted the brown. Then I just finish it out with copper. Jake, hello. How's it going? So I just kind of dumb this down, dull it down just a bit, and try to get it as close to natural as possible. Excuse me. Super loud sneezing. And at that point, I'm pretty much done. You can kind of, you know, you'll have a good finish on there. And you kind of have some of the orange highlights. We'll add a little bit of different stuff here in a bit. But I can just remove that. And you can kind of round out the body because I did looser wraps. Another cool trick is if you need to do this for like a big hex pattern, you can run a piece of uni wire through there, and then you can get cool bends in your fly as well. If you're into that super hyper cool guy realistic type stuff. So next up, we're going to run this giant curved dry fly hook. It's like a 200R-ish type hook, I would say, down through most of the body. Hey Scott, how's it going? And it goes through the cavity that we've created quite easily. And then I just pop it out. I typically try to pop it out right behind a thread wrap. So it just pokes kind of right back out behind a thread wrap there. And now we're ready to start kind of doing some stuff. I'm going to sneak some thin in here. I did forget my, actually, let's just use head cement. Hey, Scott, how's it going? Most of my tying stuff, well, I shouldn't say that. Most of my recent tying stuff is kind of packed up right now because I'm traveling heavily. So I'm just going to throw down a thread base on here. That'll kind of help to support this fly. Zappa Gap or Loctite does work the best, but when you're out of that, we'll make do. So you want to, when you advance here, you do want to kind of move that forward just a bit. Once that glue starts to set up, I don't mind a little bit of compression here. This is where our wing's going to sit. So now we're going to have a really large extended body pattern, and I want it to sit super low in the water column. I don't want this to sit up anywhere. I'm trying to see if I had my Loctite anywhere right here. Thought I did. Everything in my life is in a bag right now. It's pretty fun. So I'm just going to do a real quick, simple set of legs, and I just do some half hitches. And I only do this on the back legs. I'm not really hyper concerned with the front ones. You just want to make sure your spacing's about where you want it. And then we'll go ahead and tie those in. So those are just going to sit back kind of like that. And then I'll still just pull them half. Uh-oh. Never good. Thought my phone was blowing up. I thought I did something wrong. We're still waiting for that head cement to dry just a little bit in there, but we're gonna stop that right now. Go ahead and wrench these guys down. So if you guys happen to be in the Reno area tomorrow, I will be hanging out at the Reno Fly Shop doing some stuff all evening. Mr. Deck Hogan is gonna be there talking about spay stuff, which is cool. Probably trout spay mostly for that region. And hey Brent, how's it going? And then on Saturday I will be in Sacramento at Fly Fishing Specialties and doing a full parking lot bonanza. So this is like a misty black Farrar blend, and it's going to make up our wing. So it's actually a synthetic wing, big synthetic bug. And since it doesn't hold water, I'm good with it. Give it a few wraps in here. Second section right there. I like to use an orange dubbing. Second best one is a cinnamon caddis dub. Seems to work really well for me. Adds just that right amount of sparkle and that orange collar that salmon flies are known for. Sorry about my sniffles too. I have these petri dishes for children and they seem to bring everything home with them, which is awesome. So I'm going to move forward just about halfway, and this is where we're going to kind of start to build the head of our fly. And I'm going to go ahead and grab another set of just brown Life Flex or Super Floss, whatever you have handy. And these will become our side legs. and I just lay them in there pretty lightly. Sometimes the comments will upload, and sometimes they don't. We'll see what happens. So if I'm slow on the comments, I apologize, guys. Some sort of fuzzy. There we go. Got him. I'm going to leave these guys really long. What time in Reno? I think it starts at like 5 or 6. I'm going to be there at 5, but I think the event starts at 6. I just know times that I'm supposed to be places, which is probably very important. And last but not least, we'll just throw, I don't think these help or hurt in any way. It's more for a bin appeal type scenario, I guess you would say. So these are going to actually become our front antenna. In a second here. Alright, so next up I have this little piece of foam that I've cut out, rounded on the back. That actually will help to push the back of our wing out, and I just got to separate the legs here. So I kind of overload the front of the fly with foam. Not for any reason other than the fact that I want it to float forever and possibly not have to put as much floatant on it as one would suspect. And this is going to be McFlyon. It's just a parapost material. And I like to take my little evil creature brush and brush it out. You can omit this step if you have great visual acuity, but it's a little bit helpful if you're trying to sight it through choppy water, stuff like that. So that'll ultimately become our parapost, and then a little bit more of our cinnamon dub. Just to create that little neckline. See, now it's not reloading, booger. Loud noises by the children. So I don't mind a few extra thread wraps here. I think it's all in good taste. I'll whip finish that before I actually cut that. So I just throw the orange thread over the everything. I don't freak out about it. And if I had Zappa gap this instead of, or you know, use Loctite or whatever crazy glue, would have had a far better result. The back of my truck is thoroughly Loctited probably at this point in time. And I actually sandwich these two guys together to create the spot for the antenna. But not today. And for the bottom guy, I'm just going to trim him off right about at the eye of the hook, and all of those kind of just get sandwiched together to create this really big salmon fly pattern. Now we can go in and do a little bit of leg adjusting. So I don't want to pull tension on these. I just want to make sure they're all kind of flush,
back legs, same situation. If they're really long, don't fret. I mean, they're just going to have more movement in the water. And you can trim the parapost as you see fit. We'll put some comical little black spots on there because that's going to make all the difference as far as the confidence out of the box goes. And I'll just trim up the wing. I do a little bit of a taper cut on the wing. Just little things. Doesn't have to happen. But I like that wing to look splayed. And you guys can throw a tail, you know, a little fork tail on there if you really wanted to. Let's see. Holy snikes. Aaron, ahoy, ahoy. Lewis, hello. Aaron, ahoy again. Close up of the brush. Yeah, it's just a brush. Do salmon flies vary in size? Yeah, absolutely they can. So this is on a size 4 hook. And I'm probably at least an inch back. The one thing I've noticed is that it's probably the first big meal after the winter. So the trout are pretty darn excited to get after it. So they don't, I'm just kind of thinning out my tail here. They're not as shy, which is what makes it fun. So, and you can see, as far as the profile goes, put a white backdrop on it. A lot of orangey brown goodness going on, a little bit of UV. But that wing really doesn't stand out too much. The wings are really transparent. But yeah, so I mean, I'll tie these in 4s, 6s, and even down to an 8. And then I go 8, 10, and 12 for goldens as well. Because golden stones will also devour, or trout will also devour the golden stone, which is like the next big hatch. They are big and bigger. Right, right. Yeah, they're pretty monstrous. I mean, but yeah, so that's just a fun little salmon fly pattern that I like to fish out here. It floats forever. Hits the water with a pretty great thud. So I like the legs. If you guys can see how the legs just move, I think that's a big selling feature to the fish. I think it helps them realize that something's up there fluttering and flailing about. So you can see I tie quite a few of these. The whole box filled with them right now. Let's see here. That looks muy small on the screen, so we'll have to enhance. There we go. Not a lot of science or magic. So this is a size 6. Little curved dry fly hook. I believe the original wants a 200R. I have to bury that thing in there. I stretch my big game jaws for size 8 aughts. And I left my good jaws in the truck. Well, not my good ones. Not that either one of them are bad, but the ones I tie 90% of everything on, which are my stainless steel jaws. Whoa. I thought that was refresh. That was new tab. Hold on. We'll be back. So I've switched over to my 50D. Traditionally, the tails... thanks, John. Thanks, Abraham. Typically, the tails on Stimmies are just deer hair. But I think a really fun substitution is these goose biots in a fluorescent orange. I just kind of think they're really fun, playful, and different. And I haven't noticed any major changes in the fishing of the fly at all, so it's a way just to create like a hot spot in the pattern. And I'm just going to wrap these all the way forward and down. We have like some really strange map mix music going on right now, so it's pretty... It's not an individual band. So if it gets weird, I apologize. It is Spotify's fault. So this is just a piece of uni wire. You can use, BR or small. Do I ever fish the preserve on the McLeod? Great question, Bobby. I have, not in a number of years, just because I have, I get to fish another section of the McLeod, a little bit more regularly, which is the Bali Baca section. It's one of the spots that I guide. Aaron will be drooling here in a few seconds over it. So fish that if I fish the McLeod typically. But the Nature Conservancy is or the conservation section, for whatever it's called, is super fun. It's a limited, as you might know, it's a limited number of rods per day. So what I'm tying in here as an underbody is some Vivas tinsel. This is a holographic tinsel. It's six. I think it's like a golden brown or olive brown. It's H06 is how I know it. And simply, I'm just going to go ahead and do connecting turns. Or if I was hanging out with Davey, touching turns through the front of this. It was pretty awesome to get to hang out with Davey McPhail and pick his brain a little bit last weekend. Fortunately, I was running the booth in the front of the store while he was inside tying most of the time. But nonetheless, I got to check out a lot of his flies and check out how he manages his fly boxes, so that was pretty cool. And I'll over exaggerate my proportion because I want to make sure that I get this tied in real well. The music needs more cowbell. Bobby, do you have a question on fishing the McLeod at all? I might be able to answer it. It's not my main watershed, just because even living here, it's quite a distance for me to make it out there. And unfortunately in life, my time is somewhat limited. So this is just a brown saddle hackle. It's a really old one. I sold all of mine during the hair feather craze, and earthen brown was not a hot hair feather color for me, so it survived the hair feather girl apocalypse. So what I do is, once I have that tied in, I'll just go ahead and start palmering backwards. does need more cowbell. I can agree with that. So I'll just snake this through. Not too concerned. Don't stop until you're up front here. Hey Mark, how's it going? Your brother-in-law's still on the list? I like it. I have to go do, we're doing a catalog shoot there with the fly shop or something on, well, we're gonna do a catalog shoot and shoot photos for the fly shop on June. So I like it, Aaron. Looks fuzzy tonight to me. Maybe it's always fuzzy and I just don't notice. So now to our deer hair. So the cool thing with these stimmies is one of my favorite, I just fish a purple stimmy. You know, you got a big bag of various hairs and furs here. But you know, don't be afraid, you know, to come in and, you know, mix up, say if you wanted some orange wing or something like that. Just create stuff that's super fun that, you know, you want to fish. That's probably most important. Let's see, we'll do a refresh. Sort of wild animal outside of my door. Sounds like a small child trying to break in, cause havoc. Looks like they stole my deer skin, my deer cape. Oh, there it is. So one of the things too to really look for is I like to buy these primo capes or these strips. They're just really long. And the hair tends to be, you know, a summer harvest deer. And, you know, a little bit better tips and stuff like that. So you get a little bit more bang for your buck. Let's see. Bobby says, you had, oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, it can be really fun. Especially this year, it should be really, really good. It's always worth it if you've never been someplace to go, you know, give it a whirl, Bobby. It's definitely a great place, and you can camp there. I'm not sure if you would want to do that, but there's cool camping, and the whole preserve is it's a pretty cool experience to get there. You got to leave pretty early in the morning to be able to ensure your spot, though. That would be my only recommendation. If you're going for it, go all out and go pretty early. You can stack these if you want. I don't always stack the wings for these, but just a personal preference there. Then I'll go ahead and pass through that a few times. And before I let go of my wing, go ahead and just start trimming off stuff. I typically call this a bifly, just because I don't tie a ton of them for whatever reason. So once we have that down and put in there, go ahead and just wrap over all of that deer hair again. You know, we could have pushed that just a hair forward, but I'm pretty happy with it overall. It is also pouring rain right here in Northern California again, and it sounds like I get to drive through 5 feet of snow tomorrow to get to the other side of the Sierras, so that'll be fun. Should be actually a good time. And, you know what, Bobby? If you've never fished it, I would definitely go and fish it. It's a cool zone. Really is. So the for the front hackle, you can use grizzly. I am going to use this kind of old school Cree-ish hackle that I like a lot. It's not the highest barbule count in the world, but it's just what I have. I'll just find a good one. It carries that coloration down through. This one actually turns almost to a furnace down lower. You can tell it's old because it has fluff still, or, you know, fluffy bases to it. I think they bred that out of all of the current chickens in the genetic fly tying game. Oops, did I cut that off? Did just a little bit. So. And I'm going to use a peacock black ice dub for the head on this. You could use orange. I just get stoked out with the peacock black ice dubbing. And I didn't want to let Aaron down and have a show where I did not use it. So once I have that in there, I'll go ahead and I'll just start creating. That's a pretty big hackle, but it'll float. I'm all right with it. Dude, this song is like jamming. Now that I've thoroughly pushed all of the fur down and out, let's see, we'll do a refresh here. Right, Aaron? You didn't want to miss out. That would have been horrible. You would have been so disappointed and lost sleep over it. Stuff like that. And then I'll just color my thread since I was using that Vivas 50. And then I'll just use a little bit of our water-based head cement in there just to bind that all in. Tops and bottom. As it absorbs it, I'll just add more. I don't really worry about it. I feel like it'll make the bond a little bit better. But yeah, you kind of will get to see that profile there. You get the cool hot tail. Ends up working out pretty good. I do like the ice dub up front quite a bit, just because it seems to add a little bit more sparkle and pizzazz to your pattern. Doesn't even want to leave the vise. But you can see that thing's going to sit pretty high in that water column and just have a really cool full profile to it. I always dig flies that stand up on their own. I don't have to stick them into anything. Let's see. I don't even know what to do. Powered through that in like 42 minutes. You probably want to tune in for a while and boycott. Bobby says he'll be there for 8 days. I usually get there. Great question, Bobby. Usually get there pretty close to as early as you want to. I mean, kind of sunup. I tend to try to hit places first, be the first guy in the water, you know, get the first selection of that area. But, man down. So I think next time, but yeah, I just get there as early as you possibly can. You're just going to get the best, like the best beat, if you will. And that's just going to kind of enhance, you know, you'll get to pick the best piece of water. I haven't honestly fished it in probably about 8 years, just due to the other venue. But, you know, that time of year in June, I'd bring a good assortment of PMDs, some golden stones, and a lot of soft tackles. Large and articulated. Thank you, Matt. I appreciate it. Deal. I will do a large articulated fly next time. And then I also want to tie this little, salt creature here. Let me see if I can hold it so you guys can see it. This little fun crab pattern that I've been screwing around with. Fun little permit fly. I'll probably tie that and something really big and articulated. It's been a while. We need something worthy to go in the tank, that's for sure. But yeah, so if you guys are in Reno tomorrow evening, Reno Fly Shop is hosting a fun event with Deck Hogan and myself. And then the next day, Fly Fishing Specialties in Sacramento. I will be there and doing a big barbecue. There's tons of free food. I think they have either beer or soda. I don't know. Probably soda and water. If you can find beer, you can bring your own beer. But anyways, I got to go pack a truck up and get ready to drive for like 4 to 5 hours. So I'm going to go ahead and sign off. So next week, or not next week, but the next time we meet, we'll do something really big and articulated. And little saltwater crab with an eye tutorial that should play out over well into like crawdads and shrimp and everything like that. So as usual, thank you for tuning in, guys. Appreciate it, and we'll catch you next time. And as I refresh, it'll keep refreshing. So, all right. Well, hopefully you guys are getting out and fishing, and we'll see you next time. All right, take care.